So we're so glad you're here. Amen. So good to see everyone. Amen. This service today, I was looking forward to wearing the white to represent the complete work in claim. You know, sometimes we need to remind ourselves and wear white for some of the things we're going through too. Amen. It represents victory in our life. And I'm thankful that this was laid on Sonia Nim's heart and we did this, because sometimes we like to represent what's wrong and not what's coming. Amen. So really simple things today, but I'm going to be ministering this word today to you about restored back to life. And one of the things that really got me as I was doing that was, I get this gum in my mouth. Are y'all going to hear me chewing gum the whole service? Amen. But so good to see today too. Slipped in on us, Janet Long. Good to see you today. Good to see you. Bless your heart. Amen. And good to see and her son today too as well. So it's an honor to have y'all. Thank you for being in our house today. Thank you for being in God's house. Amen. And we're just family. These guys are family to me. Been a long time, and it's good to see them today. I want you today to look in some things with me. So at the beginning of the service, I thought it was very good, Dee. Thank you for doing that. And Baron said something about when you talk about restored to life, you talk about the things that, like cars, can be restored. And we talk about all these things that can be put back. You know, I'm a Chevelle lover. If anybody don't know that, you know it now. But I love Chevelles. I've always loved Chevelles. And you know, taking one and seeing one restored, it just makes my heart beat two or three times faster. And I just love Chevelles. I love everything about them. We had one, me and Jennifer, when we got married, we drove. The day we walked out of the church smiling, everybody throwing rice on us back then. But they throw bubbles. They spit bubbles at you today. But anyway, we walked out and got in that Chevelle. It was white with red racing stripes. It was beautiful on the outside, but the inside didn't look as pretty. It didn't have air conditioning, so Brant was very young then. And so we had to actually get rid of that Chevelle. Brant's my Chevelle. Where's it? But anyway, But she said, we got to get a car that's more family car. We got to get this. And we changed, and we bought a Cutlass Supreme Brougham. How many remember them? It wasn't Brougham's, wasn't that Brougham, but another one. Amen. But we got this car, and we traded for it. And so when he's talking about restoring to life, I'm like, Lord, he's talking about a car, and I'm just like sitting there going, yes, Lord, I receive my Chevelle in the name of Jesus. Amen. But that's a good point. But that was not what I'm preaching on today. Amen. But that's a great point on restoring back to life. It's a good example of what it is. You take a car that's older and you restore it. How many know that in our own lives we need restoration sometimes? Amen. We need life restoration. We need God to restore. We need God to renew. We need God to refresh. And we talk about this week because we're preparing for revival next weekend, next Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday. We're going to be having revival. And we talk about it a lot of times, and we think revival is an evangelist showing up, or revival is having three services instead of one. But you know, revival should be every day in our life, not just when we have somebody. Amen. Come on, somebody, don't preach with me too fast. Amen. But I want to share with you today about what real restoring back to life is, because restoring back to life can be many things in all of our lives. So I'm going to give you just some examples. But how many in here today, in some area of your life, you would like to have restored back to life? Amen. Well, what do you mean, Pastor? I'm so glad you asked. I heard you asking that. So how many has ever had a used to in your life? How many has ever said, well, used to? Well, we used to. 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 How many has ever said used to? Maybe even this week. But we used to. We used to have a prayer life. We used to read the Word. We used to witness. We used to use our talents. We used to love more. Amen. We used to give more. Amen. We used to be more faithful. Amen. We used to praise. Is it in yet? Amen. Did y'all accept it yet? What is your used to that needs to come back to life? What is your used to that needs to come back to life? I don't know what your used to is. You have a used to. I have some used to's. All of us have used to's. But the thing is that our used to's can come back to life if we let God do it. Amen? But we got to have them used to's. What is it you're used to that needs to come back to life? How many want more of God in here? Amen? That is so generic question. That's such a generic question. Is everybody cooled off in here? Because I'm really cool up here. Would you hit that for me? I'm feeling cool. We're in trouble. Amen? But what is your used to? How many want more of God? That is so generic. It is so generic on how many want more of God. We hear that question a lot. Do you want more of God? Why? Yes, I want more of God. But then you've got to go back. If you want more of God, you've got to get back into your used to's to have more of God. Because we want somebody to lay hands on us quick and we get more of God. That's not how it works. Somebody can't just pray for you and get more of God. They can agree with you to get more of God, but you're going to have to get back into some of the things God's called you to do, some of your used to's, so that God can get more of Him to you. Amen? Amen. Am I on track this morning? Are you with me? Amen? Amen. Okay, so this morning I'm going to challenge you. We have a great crowd here this morning. We got many out this morning as well. We got some that are out vacationing, different things. Hey, this is spring break week, right? Amen? So we got things happening. But I'm going to challenge you that are here. I'm going to challenge you. And I want you to challenge them. So you get to text or call them right after service and challenge them. But I want to challenge you to help me make priorities in your life right now. Schedule right now. You say, Pastor, this is so... it's so just not right. Well, we prioritize for everything. How many know what you're doing next weekend? Some of us do, right? Y'all ain't going to lift your hand for nothing on that one, was you? How many know what you're doing the next weekend? How many know what you're doing the next weekend? Some of you have got your calendars made out. You know what you're doing tomorrow. Some of you have already got a calendar made out. But I'm going to tell you something. I want you to take your calendar, and for next Sunday morning and next Monday night and next Tuesday night, I want us to show God that we're serious about getting our used to's back in our life, and let's make a commitment. Well, Pastor, don't get off till 7. Then come on anyway. We'll still be having church when you get here. Amen? You'll make it to anything else. Come on, let's be faithful to the revival next Sunday. Amen? And Monday. Amen? Oh, I wasn't as strong on that. I said Monday. Amen? Tuesday. Amen? So you say, Pastor, that's enough of that. Okay, that's enough of that. But the thing is, it's a challenge. So I want to see who's going to prioritize and take my challenge and be here every night and seek God on what your used to is in your life. Amen? Amen? All right. I just had to encourage you. So now I'm going to preach. Acts, the second chapter, verse 40 through 47. I want to take you back to the early church. Revival is something that, as I said, it's not a meeting. It's not an evangelist. It's when you and I get serious with God. Can somebody say amen? Amen. So we go to the book of Acts, the second chapter, verse 40. Says, and when many other words... he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. How many know that we're living in a very perverse generation? I'm going to tell you right now, we live in a very perverse generation, more than ever before. People say, well, you know, I've heard people say about Sodom and Gomorrah, God's going to have to ask forgiveness, because if he destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, it hadn't destroyed America. Well, if you look at Sodom and Gomorrah, it was bad, and it was very, very bad, and God destroyed it, not because of all their very badness. If you read the word, he destroyed it because he couldn't find any righteous. Amen. Read your word, amen? So I look at this today and I see our perverse generation. I see a generation that is perverse. They're more about what they can get than what others can receive. Amen? They're more about themselves than they are others. See, perverse means many different things. But a generation that we see today is more about what I can get, not about anyone else. Verse 41 says this. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized. And that day there was 3,000 souls added to the church. I just want you to think for a minute. Today, we were at the back door before praise and worship. We get here a little earlier, 9:30-ish. And they were about done about after 10. And we're all standing at the door waiting to come in. And I said, wow, this could be, we could take a picture of us all standing at the door. But the only thing bad about the picture, I was standing at the door too. The pastor couldn't even get in the church. I don't know if I want to go there or not. But I looked at this and I thought, man, what a day this would be if you seen 3,000 people saved. And they baptized them the same day. Pastor didn't get done that day. He ended his day about 4 o'clock probably. Amen. He was baptizing. Can you imagine 3,000 people in one day? You say, Pastor, this is just the Bible. It's not possible. Why is it not possible? If it was possible for the early church, it's possible for the church today. Amen. Yeah. It's the same Jesus yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. Are we serving the same Jesus? So we look on at the next verse, and we see here that 3,000 souls were added to them. But watch what happened after. They continually, steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and look at this last word, and in prayer. How many know prayer is the key to revival? Amen? Prayer is the key to revival. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. How many would like to come in here next Sunday and the signs and wonders of God would just be among us. Amen? Amen. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common. I like this part. They sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had a need. Amen? Amen. Can you imagine? I have a need. I need da-da-da-da-da-da. And D sells everything he's got to take care of my need. Isn't that a blessing? Amen. Somebody say, God bless D. But you see, the thing is, we're never about giving. We're about receiving. Come on, amen. But see, the early church understood that you not only got revival by receiving, but by giving. Amen. So let's look at this. So continually, daily, with one accord in the temple. How often? I just want to make sure y'all catch that. How often? How often do we come to church? Thank you, Clay. You're the only honest one in the building. Amen. Clay said, once a week. Once a week. The thing is, the Bible says they daily, in one accord, went to the temple. So let me help you understand today what it's talking about just a little bit, because, you know, there's no way we're going to have church every day of the week, but if God says so, we will. Amen. But the thing is this was happening. They would go to the temple daily in one accord, believing God for whatever it is they're praying for. So you're telling me, Pastor, they had a daily prayer life, not a weekly prayer life. Amen. So they were one accord in the temple. They broke bread from house to house. They didn't just go to the temple, but they fellowshiped with one another. Come on, somebody say amen there. And they ate their food. I like that part. This is how you get a crowd. This is how they did 3,000 souls. They fed them, amen. They had a barbecue. That'll do it every time, amen. How many know when you have a dinner, everybody comes? Everybody shows up when there's dinner, right? I mean, you can be just rocking along with a few little people, and, you know, we can have our crowd here. But we have a dinner next Sunday. Woo! We got everybody here. Everybody felt the Lord leading them that Sunday. Amen? I believe we ought to be faithful. Amen, Pastor. Yeah, amen. They ate their food with gladness. Amen. I like eating people's food with gladness. How many's with me? Amen. I mean, let me try yours. I told them to do it Buffalo Wings. I'm not going to order anything. I'm just going to try everybody else's. Amen. I've got it figured out, D. Just kidding. Okay, back to the word. food got me on food. I go off. Amen. They ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart. I like that because the simplicity of heart means they were sincere in what they were doing. Amen. And they were doing this that just got me. They were praising God. In the next verse, it goes on to say the simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with some of the people. I'm glad y'all are reading with me because I thought it said some. Because I thought we could pick and choose who we like. I thought we could pick and choose who we want to hang out with. No, Clay says no. It's all. How many know all? We praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord did what? Added to the church daily for those who were being saved. I want you to understand. How many want to see people saved at TPF? How many want to continue to see people saved at TPF? I'm going to say it that way. Amen. Because we have seen people saved. We have seen it. But I want to see people really come in and give their life to Jesus and see a change in their life. Not living the same old life. Not letting the devil lie to them anymore. But helping them become strong Christians so they can be confident in their faith. And so they can go out and lead somebody else to Jesus. And they can lead somebody else to Jesus. And the Bible says that when we are praising Him and having favor with all the people, the Lord will add to the church. We a lot of time want to spiritualize this, but sometimes the only reason God can't add any more to the church is because maybe He can't add them because we ain't ready. Amen? See, there's been many great revivals. There was great awakening way back in the early years. Great awakening. How many's ever heard of the Great Awakening Revival? If you ain't ever studied revivals, you probably wouldn't know. How many's ever heard of the Azusa Street Revival? There's hands, a few hands went up there. How many have ever heard of the Brownsville Revival? A lot of hands went up there. You know why? Because it was the most recent that we know about that took place. They called it a breakout revival. It was over 4 million people came through the doors in 5 years. Some people are like, oh, wow. Wow, that's a lot of people. That's a lot of people, but how many saved through that revival, amen? How many people got something through the revival? 2 years prior to the revival, I did some study on it. 2 years prior to revival, pastor of the church asked them to start praying for revival. He wasn't talking about a meeting. He was talking about a revival in your individual lives. Over 4 million people attended from 1995 until year 2000. And they were having service every single day. Praise and worship, are y'all ready? Cameron, are you ready to play the guitar every single day? You know what I'd hear? You know what we'd say? We're going to have church every day in the month of June. Well, Pastor, I won't be able to do that. I've got this, and I've got that, and I've got this over here. You want to see your family saved? Oh, yeah. Well, I hope they get saved the night you're gone. I get to call and tell you about it. Amen? So you see, people, here's the thing. It's not how many days and nights you go in a revival, but if God challenged us to something, if God set something out there for us, how many would meet the challenge? I mean, we're talking about Sunday morning, Monday, and Tuesday. We're not talking about 5 years every single day. Amen? You know what happened? You know why a revival stopped? People came from that church that were members of that church, and they said, we want our church back. You know what they said? They want their group back. They want the people back. They don't want all these people coming from other places around the world to hear about Jesus and to fall in love with Him and all these things. They stopped it. How many know that you and I have a place to stop revival? We can stop it. We can start it, and we can stop it. How many know one thing that all these revivals have in common is they began when believers started coming together and praying not for their own needs, but praying for the needs of others to see lives saved. Amen. You know, when's the last time that your prayer life sounded something like this? Lord, save the lost. Deliver those that are bound with addictions. How many, when's the last time you prayed that prayer? We want revival, but see, revival is souls being saved. Revival is addictions being broken. Revival is when the church people, the believers of God, are rejoicing and praising God and having favor with one another. And when God sees that, he can't help but just keep adding to the church. Amen? TPF, I don't think you understand. We've been having revival since last year. There's something that took place in this church last year. We've been seeing revival for a year. We've been seeing people saved. We've been seeing people added to the church. Do you know why? It's because we've been praising him and we've been given favor among all people. Amen? Come on. I ain't talking about a dead church. I'm not preaching this to a dead church. I'm preaching this to a church that knows what it is to be revived. God don't just send people to our church because our building is beautiful. Amen? They pull up and go, this is it? This is it, baby. But what's inside? Come on, amen? See, they look on me outside. That's just Dwayne Driggers. He's just a cell phone guy. He's been doing that for years and years and years. I was at McDonald's yesterday eating breakfast, by the way. And somebody there knew me from my past. And they know I'm a minister. They know I'm a preacher. They know all about this. Because his wife's in the hospital. All this some days ago. We was at the hospital and saw him. But I want you to see something. He remembered me from being in the cell phone business. Donnie, you've been in the cell phone business many years ago. Back when it was something. All tell or something like that. I'm just kidding. But I tell you how old it was back in. She's not that old though. The business is. I want to clarify. Amen. But I tell you these things to show you that people recognize you from the outside as for what you've done or what you're doing or who you are. But see, the thing they need to see is it's not who you are, but who's on inside of you. Amen? Come on, somebody in this building, talk to me this morning, because revival is happening at TPF, and we need not just take it for granted, but we need to keep on praising, and we need to keep on having favor with all men. And God said, I'll keep on adding to the church. Come on, are you with me? Amen. But see, I believe each of us in this building have a need. I asked before service how many has a need. Everybody raised their hand. We prayed for those needs. There's nothing wrong with praying for your needs. There's not a thing wrong with that. And we should pray for your needs. And we should pray for the needs on the cross. And we should pray for those needs that are among us. We should pray for those. But church, sometimes we get so our prayer life becomes about us and not about others. My prayer list is not about me. My prayer list is about others. Psalms 85 and 6 says, will you not revive us again? That your people may rejoice in you? Will you not revive us again? The word revive means be restored back to life. Being restored back to life. Will you not restore us back to life again, Lord? See, there's some people that are in this building today that you hear it and you see it, but you've never maybe experienced what revival is. Amen? Revival comes in a way that you and I don't think. It's not that meeting. It's not that evangelist. Let me tell you what revival is and when it happens. And I've kind of told you this already, but I want to read it to you because I want you to understand. It is a realization of great need. Revival brings forgiveness. Somebody say amen. Revival will bring deep conviction of sin. How many know we need to hear and see that again? Amen. You don't hear about conviction in church anymore. You know what we hear about in church? Prosperity, and there's nothing wrong with that. I'll preach that too, amen? But church, we got to get back to seeing the conviction of sin again. Because if I don't preach the conviction of sin and people ain't being saved from sin, they're on their way to hell. Then I'm going to stand before God for that, amen? Followed by, see, after there's conviction of sin, there needs to be a following of that. And there needs to be repentance. And there needs to be a fresh experience of that joyful obedience. Amen? Amen. This experience begins with personal changes. Somebody say amen. Amen. See, with today's salvation, we lead you through a prayer and hope to goodness you live right. I said we need some personal changes, amen? Resulting in the transformation of society. The Bible says we're not to be conformed to this world, but we are to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Amen? Amen. That's what we're supposed to be doing. A.W. Tozer has said, revival changes the moral climate of a community. You want to change community? Just let revival break out in your life. Amen? Amen. Revival brings great joy. Let me tell you something. Pensacola was forever changed in their climate. They were forever changed in the atmosphere of their community. They were forever changed in there. People stood for hours to get in there to one service. Revival brings great joy. It's found back in the people of God. The Bible said in Nehemiah, it says, the joy of the Lord. Come on, help me, church. I said, the joy of the Lord. How many's ever heard a believer say, I just don't have any strength left? How many's ever said them words out of your mouth? I just don't have any strength to make it. The Bible tells us that the joy of the Lord is my strength. As soon as that word comes out of my mouth, I ought to recognize that something is not right in my life. Amen? Because the joy of the Lord is my strength. Does joy mean that I'm always happy? Does joy mean I'm always jumping? Does joy mean I'm just like everything's perfect? No, joy is an inner part of you that says we can make it. We can overcome this. We will overcome this through the power of the Word of God. Amen? For the work has been done in their life. A passionate love relationship. God is looking for someone to fall in love with Him. The Bible tells us in Revelation, the problem with the church was they had everything going, but they had lost their first love. Do you know that's one thing that you see more and more in the church sometimes is that people have fell out of love with Jesus. They fell in love with church. They fell in love with spaghetti dinners. They fell in love with the big events that are going on. They fell in love with the men's group and all the men's doing and the women and the Bible studies. And they're so in love with that. That's not what we're supposed to be in love with. We're supposed to be in love with Jesus. When you're in love with Jesus, all them things come. Amen? So let me get into this. A little more here. Now, I'm about done. Many times, as the excitement of a relationship with Christ grows cold, how many times have you seen people, they were so excited, and yet they're not excited today? This is what we call losing the zeal for what we once had. When become many relationships, I'm going to say this, I'm going to hit it while I'm here. Many relationships go through this. Do you remember when you first fell in love with that one beside you? Or the one behind you? Or your friend that you like so much, you just think you're the best friend ever, amen? But I want to tell you something. Relationships grow cold over years. But you know why? Because people allow it to. Me and Jennifer, we just as hot as we used to be. Just look at me, amen? Oh, that wasn't the hotness we were looking for, amen? But our relationship could have drawn cold. Our relationship could have went cold over the years. We've had a perfect marriage, and we've never been through anything. We've never had nothing happen to us. And if you believe that, then I've got land in Arizona on the ocean. Amen? I'm telling you, we've been through some stuff in our life. How many has been through some stuff in your life? Amen? Don't everybody raise your hand in your marriage because you don't want an elbow or anything. Amen? But we've been through some stuff, haven't we, babe? We've been through some hard times. We've been through some good times. We've been through some amazing times. And then we've been through the ones that are kind of like, oh, whew, glad that's over, amen? But the thing is our relationship is still together. It blows my mind when people in the spiritual walk, they're walking with God, and they're walking with God, and then they start pulling back from God and pulling back from God. And they blame God for this, and they blame God for that, and they blame God for this over here. Do you understand who you're blaming? The one that gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe on Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. He sacrificed everything so your sins could be forgiven, and you're whining over what and blaming God for who? I know, I hope this will help you today, amen? But sometimes we come so bogged down with the things of life, amen? With the world's problems and with our problems and with their problems. And we find ourselves going through the motion sometimes. How many's ever just went through the motion? Praise and worship. Preaching time. Everybody stand to your feet. We're going to dismiss. We say a prayer. Everybody go home. God bless you. Have a good week. We go through the motions. Go through the motions. If I can just get to church and go through the motions, nobody maybe will recognize or think I'm going through anything. Maybe they won't recognize it. So I'm going to go to church. I'm just going to go through the motion and I'm going to do my thing. You know what? You didn't fail me or anybody around you. You failed God. But we no longer, see, want to experience the joy of serving Christ. We want somebody else to be serving us. We want somebody else to be blessing us. We want somebody else to be feeding us. You know, there was a time in my life my mama fed me. And then she flipped the spoon around and she said, feed yourself. Flipped the spoon around and said, feed yourself. Sometime on Sunday morning, we might ought to try it. How's y'all's week? Mine's been good. Feed yourself. Well, that I ain't going back to that church. That pastor didn't even preach. He didn't give me nothing to live on that week. He didn't give me nothing from the Word of God. You know, the thing is we're depending on pastor. We're depending on me to feed you. But it's not my place to come and feed you every day at your house. Come on, I'll text you tomorrow. Did you read the Bible? Did you pray? You know, how many remember being home? Mom said, did you do the chores? I tell you, when I was growing up, I'm so thankful for my mom. She done a lot of the chores. Hallelujah. My wife is the one that broke me and nudge taught me about chores. I remember when I'd go home, mom would cook and I'd go home, mom have every, I'd walk in the house and I'd be headed in the kitchen and she'd go, where are you heading, son? I said, I'm going to get me something to drink. Sit down, son, I'll get it for you. Everybody say that, my mama, amen. It didn't matter who you was. You come into mom's house, you sit down, and she served you. That's your mama. Ain't your mama? Clay, you ain't supposed to be talking right now. That's good, Clay. Sorry, Mom. Didn't mean to throw you under the bus over there. But Clay, my mama would get me something to drink. So try it when you go home. Say, pastor's mama did it. See how that works out. Amen. But thing is mom would always serve me when I'd sit down. She'd give me something to drink. And my wife, she did that for just a short period. And every now and then, she still does it. I don't feel good or something. You know, she'll, let me get something to drink, baby. But you know, she does that. Still, I'm not going to say she don't. Amen. So I got to go home. But I ain't going to be like Clay. But there's one thing is, I had to learn really fast. My wife taught me I had 2 feet and 2 hands and get to the refrigerator. Amen. It's not any further distance for you to go than me to go. My mama didn't think like that, you know. And then she taught me there was such thing as a washing machine. I just thought that you took the clothes off and you threw them down in the floor. That's what mama taught me. Mama always picked them up and put them in the hamper. And mama always washed them and they were dry and they were clean. Mama always. Are you with me? You know, sometimes we compare God like that to how he ought to beat us. We want a God that's always just handed, just this. We serve a God that we serve. He ain't ours. Somebody say, we serve God. We serving God. God will give back to us. God will give to us. But we shouldn't be waiting on God to do everything for us. Sometimes we got to do our part to get his part. Amen? Yes, sir. Just a little story, real quick. If my people, that's talking about God's people. Come on, amen. 2 Chronicles 7:14 says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves. How many know this is a big deal right here? Humble themselves. And pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Amen. Do you know the one point that we like to always preach on this is pray and seek his face. And how many know we should be doing that? Amen. But this first part says, call by my name if they'll humble themselves. Do you know pride is one of the biggest things that keep everybody from doing what they should do? Well, I used to do this. I used to do that in the church. I used to do that in the church. Then what happened? Well, so and so. It was back then. But you're still blaming for then, for now? Yep. Sound like there's some pride. Sound like it's maybe some unforgiveness. What's good in here? I knew I hit something right then. I heard it. My name will humble themselves. See, the first thing today to get personal revival is if my people will humble themselves. See, we're not here finger pointing at anybody. We're going to return to God. We're going to take the church and we're going to be the church as individuals returning back to him. But we got to return to him in humbleness. Amen. Let me give you what humble means. It's not proud. It's not arrogant. It's not thinking you're better than other people. The quality or state of being humble. A lot of times they're thinking we are better. I believe we have seen this from pulpits to church seats. Yeah. I'll say it one more time. People thinking they're better than others, we've seen it from pulpits to the church seats. Amen. I'm no better than anybody in this room. I'm just like you. I'm just like, we hanging out. Amen. We just down here, right? There's no difference in us. The only difference is God called me to preach and he called you to be there, to witness, to pray, to say amen, to say hallelujah, to do something for him. I don't know what God's called you to do, but God's called you to do something. Amen. But he's called many people to do things, and yet we've allowed pride to keep us from doing it. If I would allow pride to stay in my life, I would have never returned back to what God called me to do. Pride. The Bible says pride will come before a great fall. See, the thing is, people don't like to hear about pride because it talks about them personally. James 4:6 says this, everybody wants grace. How many wants grace? I said, how many wants grace? But he who gives more grace, therefore he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Help me read that one more time. I wonder, how many want grace? Because if you want grace, if you got pride, God resists the proud, but if you want grace, he can only get grace to the humble. Is that what it says? How can we turn this nation back to God if we individually can't get our own life in order? We like to blame America, we like to blame politicians, and we like to blame Hollywood. And the blame is in the mirror. If you had voted differently, or you had done this, no. You want revival in this land, it ain't going to come who's in White House. It's going to come as who's in God's house. Amen? Now, you didn't hear me. I said it ain't going to matter who's in the White House. It's going to matter who's in God's house. Amen? Who is there praying, seeking his face, saying, God, I need revival in my life. God, what can I do? I want to be used, God. We all can make a difference. Can I hear an amen to that? God will not send revival until we, his people, humble ourselves. God cannot fill people with the Spirit if they're full of themselves. Amen. There is real danger in our lives of having a satisfied spirit. Do you know what a satisfied spirit is? I'm glad you asked. Because satisfied means this. I'm good. I don't have any problems. I don't have anything going on. I'm good. But as soon as something bad happens, Soon as something bad happens, it's everybody else's fault. If D would have prayed like he should have when I went up there for prayer, we wouldn't be going through this. If Jennifer would have prayed, if Cameron would have prayed, if Sonia would have spoke the right thing, if Vern or Trent or if someone else in the church would have just prayed differently, if they just said the right words, then I wouldn't be going through this. No, the problem ain't on anybody else. They only agree with you in prayer, in faith. It is your faith that has to touch God sometimes. Amen? And the thing is we don't want to take responsibility for our failures sometimes. You see, the problem with America is not the darkness in America, but it's the light that's not in America. Each of us are to be the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Come on, somebody say amen. Because the Bible says we're the light. It is time for us to stop blaming everyone else and turn the light back on. 1 Peter 5:6, Christy, you come on, we'll make your way back. 1 Peter 5:6 says, humble yourself, therefore, under God's mighty hand. Humble yourself under God's mighty hand that he may exalt you. Or the Bible says the word exalt means to lift up in due time. I'm going to ask you a very strong question today on everyone that's here. If you was put on trial today, if everybody can listen to me just for this moment. If you were put on trial today, is there enough evidence in your life to prove you are a Christian? I'm not talking about how many times you attend church. Because that's the first place people go is, oh, I attend church every Sunday. Hallelujah. And I'm thankful for those faithful people. Amen. I lifted my hands in the praise and word. That just doesn't matter. What evidence in your life daily do you have to prove that you're a Christian? What is it? What is it in your life that if you were put on trial and you were sitting on that place and a judge was sitting there, he looked over and he said, there's not enough evidence to prove that they're a Christian. That's our case today. And the prosecuting attorney steps up and says, da 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 da. And then the other one, they all step up and they do say their part. But how many know there was a man named Stephen? He was being stoned. You can read it in the Bible. He was being stoned to death for his faith. Some of us even thought there was a chance of that. We might lose our faith. Amen. But Stephen was being stoned for his faith. The Bible says when he looked up, the only place in the Bible, Stephen looked up, the only place in the Bible where it says Jesus stood up. The Bible says that when Stephen looked up, he saw Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father. Some of y'all ain't hearing me. There was enough evidence to prove he was a Christian. He was being stoned for his faith. He was being stoned for who he was. And yet he stood there and took it. But see, while that pain was coming at him, I believe that Jesus stepped up and held the pain and began to block them rocks. His life began to go, and all of a sudden he stepped into the hands of glory. Come on, are you with me this morning? I don't understand all of what we go through, but church, I'm here today to tell you Jesus is the one, the only one that can look into your life and say, that is my child. I can look out here today and say, I think all of you are Christians. That don't mean nothing. I can't see your heart. I can see you in church today, but I can't see your heart. I don't know if your heart is right or not right with God. But I do know one thing. When pride begins to break off of our life, and I say I'm ready to be revived, then all those areas of my life that used to be will come back and come back greater than they ever were before. Amen. Come on, amen. Give him some praise this morning. We're going to do this just a little different today. Christy's got a song on her heart. We're going to sing here in just a moment. But right as we get ready to do that today, I usually have everybody stand at this point. I usually have everybody stand. Let's pray. I felt so different about this today. Because pride is the biggest thing to keep us held back. Pride says, don't go, what people going to think about you. Pride says, don't move, don't you dare go for prayer, because if you go up there, somebody's going to think something about you. Well, the first person that thinks about somebody else that steps up forward, you come on right with them, amen? Because if you can sit and think about somebody else while they're coming to the altar, you need to be in the altar, amen? This morning's going to be a little different, but it's going to be maybe for one or two or five or 10 or 15 or 20. But I can tell you this one thing. I believe I'm in a church full of people that want to be closer to God, that want pride off of their life, and they want to be free, and they got some used to's in their life. And that's the very first call I want to make today, is if you got some used to's in your life and you want to see them come back, come on, get out of your seat. Come on, don't let that pride hold you back. Used to I this, and used to I that, and used to this over here, and used to that.